Well, good morning. Good morning, folks of Beaver Dam. I am Pastor Owen, and I have the pleasure of being the minister here at Beaver Dam and Rousey's Chapel. And I am so glad that you are joining us for our 11 o'clock Sunday worship. Please let us know that you're there. Drop us a line in the comment box, letting us know that you're joining us live on Facebook, or if you happen to be catching this service at another time. And it's also a great place for you to leave your prayer concerns and praises. I am hoping by now that you've noticed a little change in our audio portion of our broadcast. We're changing things up a little bit each time, and I think we've got the sound down to where it should be coming through clear. If you're liking the change, let us know. Drop us a line in that comment box. I'm always thankful for the folks who help make this live stream possible, from Freddie and Van, who helped main the audio and the visual, to a couple of other people who are in here just to kind of give us a little bit of moral support. I'd just like to remind you that each weekday morning at 8 o'clock, we also have a Facebook Live time of reflections. It's a time for a daily devotional. So if you have the opportunity, join us each day of the week for our devotional. School is starting back here real soon. I believe we've got some kids over in Caroline that are starting back tomorrow. So since it is that time, it's time to have a blessing of the book packs, book bags. So we're going to do that a little differently this year. We're going to have a couple of different things going. One, we'll be doing a drive-through blessing of the book bags at 4 to 5 p.m. on September the 3rd. And also, if that time doesn't work for you, just shoot me an email, drop me a text, and we'll figure out a way that we can make that happen. So just as a way to help kick the new school year off. So friends, now let us take this time to prepare our hearts and mind for worship. Friends, let us join our voices in our call to worship, which was sent out in our circuit rider on Friday. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. We belong to God. When we feel overwhelmed, God is on our side. When we are afraid, God will keep us safe. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Blessed be the Lord. Amen. Friends, now let us prepare to hear the word proclaimed today and meditate on our opening hymn, The Church's One Foundation.
Is Jesus Christ her Lord? She
Friends, God's grace is available to all of us, and we have God's word to inspire and guide us along our journey. So let us prepare to hear God's word read and proclaimed today with our prayer of illumination. Let us pray. Lord, be with us today. We have come seeking your guidance and your direction for our lives. Help us to recognize the gifts that you have freely given to us, and transform us with your love as your word is read and proclaimed today. We ask all of this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. So our first reading this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Romans. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. Listen to these words from the Apostle Paul. So, brothers and sisters, because of God's mercies, I encourage you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice that is holy and pleasing to God. This is your appropriate priestly service. Don't be conformed to the patterns of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds so that you can figure out what God's will is, what is good and pleasing and mature. Because of the grace that God gave me, I can say to each one of you, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Instead, be reasonable, since God has measured out a portion of faith to each one of you. We have many parts in one body, but the parts don't all have the same function. In the same way, though, there are many parts of us. We are one body in Christ, and individually we belong to each other. We have different gifts that are consistent with God's grace that has been given to us. If your gift is prophecy, you should prophesy in proportion to your faith. If your gift is service, devote yourself to serving. If your gift is teaching, devote yourself to teaching. If your gift is encouragement, devote yourself to encouraging. The one giving should do it with no strings attached. The leader should lead with passion. The one showing mercy should be cheerful. And the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 16, verses 13 through 20, Peter's declaration about Jesus. Now, when Jesus came area of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the human one is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the other prophets." He said, "And what about you? Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Then Jesus replied, Happy are you, Simon, son of Jonah, because no human has shown this to you. Rather, my Father who is in heaven has shown you. I tell you that you are Peter, and I will build my church on this rock. The gates of the underworld won't be able to stand against it. I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Anything you fasten on earth will be fastened in heaven. Anything you loosen on earth will be loosened in heaven. Then he ordered the disciples not to tell anybody that he was the Christ. Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Every once in a while when I'm preparing a sermon, a perfect theme song comes to mind. And today is one of those Sundays. Freddie, can you play the theme song for today?
Where would you like to start?
After a commercial break. You can tell I'm a lover of classic rock and roll music. And if you're not familiar with that song, it's by The Who. Who Are You? That was just a snippet of the song that was used for the intro to the TV show CSI, Crime Scene Investigation. The whole song is asking a simple question. Who are you? I really want to know, who are you? That can be a tough question to answer at times. How would you answer that question? Who are you? I'm sure that you might be like me and have been known in several ways throughout your life. My life started off with me being known as that cute baby. Yes, I was cute, like Gerber baby cute. You can ask my mom. She will tell you and confirm that. Then, of course, I was known as June and Bob's son, or maybe Jack's brother. And then after I met Tina, I was known as Tina's boyfriend, or her fiancé, or as I am known now, as Tina's first husband. When we had kids, I immediately became known as John and Nicole's dad. My scouts knew me as Mr. Taylor. The kids over at the daycare center now know me as Mr. Owen. And you guys know me as Pastor Owen. So the question of who am I really depends on who you ask and who they say I am. For in their eyes, I might be known as a son or a brother, a husband, a scoutmaster, a dad, a pastor, and the list goes on and on and on. But there's a common thread to all of that and to all of those answers, and it's a thread that we all share. And that is, who people say we are depends on the relationship that we have with them. The closer the relationship, the more intimate the answer. There's a huge difference between me being Mr. Taylor and me being Tina's husband. I think that is what Jesus was trying to get to in today's text when he asked the disciples a question, who do people say I am? It shows that folks were trying to figure out who Jesus was. For the disciples answered Jesus by saying, some people say you're John the Baptist. Others say Elijah, and still others say Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. This shows us that those who only encountered Jesus occasionally didn't get a full view of who Jesus was. They didn't see the entire picture of who Jesus is. And I believe the same thing can be said for some folks today. I know that I have been there, and you probably have known people who only have known God superficially. Sure, they believe that there's a God, but they only pray to God in times of trouble. Or they come to worship when there's nothing better to do, or only at Christmas and Easter when it's truly expected that you would be in church. They don't have an active, engaged faith life. They aren't experiencing or seeing how much hope and love can be found in a true relationship with their Creator. But there's good news for those folks, that they don't have to stay in that part, that way of a relationship, because God is there for all of us. Now, kind of back to our text for today. Jesus' questioning of the disciples goes deeper. He's standing there with all 12 of them around them, and he asks, "Who do you say I am?" Jesus, by asking the 12 disciples this question, is inviting them into a deeper, closer relationship with him. Even though you would think that the answer would have been quick and easy, but was it really? I can almost envision them getting a little squirmy when Jesus asked them that question, "Who do you say I am?" I could see them looking at each other, maybe whispering to each other, "What does he mean?" I can see them looking down at their feet or off at a distance, trying to do anything to avoid making eye contact with Jesus. I wonder, giving him the wrong answer. Perhaps. But then we have good old Simon Peter there. And he's willing to answer for the entire group when he says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus, in Simon Peter's answer, sees that he gets it. That Peter is declaring for all of us that Jesus is the one that we have been looking for, the one that we need, whether we're aware of it or not. That this Messiah is the one who comes from God, who is the essence with God, the Son of the living God. Peter declares, whether he realizes it or not, that it is Jesus who connects us, who brings us together human need and divine presence, and the one who reconciles, who puts all of our brokenness back together with God's wholeness. It's here, realizing who Jesus really is, that we can start growing in our faith, creating that intimate relationship that God wants to have with each and every one of us. You know, it's interesting to note that this particular encounter with Jesus and his disciples appears in all four of the Gospels. So that tells us that this is an important story. But it's only here in Matthew's Gospel that we get the part where Jesus tells Peter that he is the rock which he will build his church. Now, the word Peter actually does mean rock. And the name Peter wouldn't have been used in biblical times, for who in the world would want to name their kid Rock? So what is Jesus doing here when he calls Simon the Rock? Jesus was starting to build the church. Church, when I say church, capital C, universal in nature, not one particular denomination. He was laying the foundation that the church is to be built upon. It has meaning for us today. We can look at it this way. If you and I, are being transformed by our relationship with Jesus, and if we identify with those who belong to Christ, then we are willing to be foundational. We are willing to be built upon. The Apostle Paul talks of Christ as the cornerstone of the church. But it's here in Matthew's gospel that tells us that Peter, and I believe as an extension of all of us, is the foundation. Jesus is the builder, and we are the materials. We are the ones who give shape to the building that is the church. And if we are part of the church, then we are called to serve the church by supporting where we can through our prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. God works through us and in us to build the church, which is the kingdom of God. And if we continue on in our text to verse 18, we read that the gates of the underworld won't be able to stand against it. It being the church. It being the community in which we are a part of. It being what we are called to be, the body of Christ. The underworld, or Hades as it's also called, was seen as the realm of the dead, which means it will not end. And I find it funny because all things that are made by humans have a lifespan. Nothing that humans make lasts forever. Institutions, lifestyles, civilizations, governments all rise and fall. But the church, not necessarily any denomination, but the church will survive into eternity. That is a promise that is made from God. That means for us that we should be bold as we seek to give shape to the church. We can't kill the church. It also means that an attack from the evil forces of wickedness that are in the world will not succeed either in destroying the church. We don't need to live in fear of any kind of attack from evil. For we, my friends, are stronger than we realize when God is by our side. That's pretty amazing, isn't it, when you really think about it? That there's no reason to fear failure when Christ tells us the church will endure. Let's bring that down to our local level here. What does that mean for us here at Rousey's Chapel and Beaver Dam? What does it mean for us to take that risk of without fear of failure? In the name of Christ and the church, where can all of this lead us? Where should it lead us? Now next, we have this image in verse 19 of Jesus giving the keys of the kingdom to Peter. And the talk of fastening and loosening on earth as and in heaven. We'll talk about the giving of the keys first. The question is Jesus giving the keys to the kingdom Jesus' way of establishing a hierarchical system for the church? Is he offering Peter the ability to determine who is in and who is out? And going even further, is it now the church's job to determine the worthiness for eternity and entry into heaven? Some over the ages have argued, yes, it does. But both believe that this argument is wrong. So what are the keys that Jesus is handing over to Peter? What is the power that now resides in our church and in the church's hands? The keys are to knowledge. The keys to the kingdom is knowledge. And not just any knowledge, but the knowledge of the identity of Christ. The keys to the kingdom that were handed to Peter, knowledge of who Jesus is. Y'all, we are called to teach and to interpret who Jesus is for the world. And fastening and loosing is a description of the way about how we can interpret the scriptures for those around us so that they can become and understand in the world that we live in today. We are to inform and to share and to teach about God, the God who is the answer to our prayers, the desire of all our hearts, and the fulfillment of all our needs. We are called to share the identity of Christ with the world so that all can become part of the community called the church. We share Christ with the world by showing others God's love to everyone that we meet. We share Christ to the world by telling others how God is active in our lives and in our community. We should be living in a way that people will ask, "Why do you do what you do? How can you be so loving? How can you care about me so much?" Friends, the answer to them is simple. We do what we do because of God, because of who we say God is. For really, when we think about it, in the end, when God asks us, when we ask God, "God, who do you say I am?" We want that answer to be a follower of mine. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, friends, let us now meditate on the word with our hymn of response, "We Believe."
Doubt and fear.
Friends, this is our time during worship where we normally share our praises and our prayer concerns, and we also provide an offering. And I want to tell you a story about how our church is continuing to minister to the community. Early in the week, I took a phone call at the church office from a family who needed a little help paying their rent because the father of the household had tested positive to COVID-19. Thank goodness he didn't develop any symptoms, but he was out of work for a while, which caused them to fall behind in their bills. So we were able to help this family who lives in one of the surrounding communities, but not too far away from us. And that is through the faithfulness of your tithes and offerings. So I encourage you to continue bringing in your tithes and offerings, whether you're mailing them in here or giving online through the website, which hopefully you can see the site address in the lower third of the screen, or whether we come by and pick it up. However it is, we are continuing the mission of the church. So now let us go to the Lord in prayer with all of our concerns. Let us pray. Almighty God, there are far too many times when we have neglected or ignored the needs of others because it just wasn't convenient for us to help. We backed away with excuses on our lips and an indifference in our hearts. Forgive us and set us on the right path of service and compassion in the name of Jesus, who modeled faithful living for us. Remind us that we are residents of a global community. Help us to hear the plight of those who have been voiceless with the gifts that we have and the love of Christ. Direct our lives in compassionate service to others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Mighty healer, we remember this day our dear friends who suffer from illnesses and loss. Lord, help us to be a presence of comfort for them and for those who are lost and alone, those who are alienated from family and friends. We ask that you empower us to reach out in compassion, offering the appropriate help that will lift them up into a new life with you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Great protector, we pray for all of those who are in situations of danger, war, and strife, wherever they may be. We pray that your peace will be with them and that the dangers will be vanquished by your good news. We pray for the safety as folks on the Gulf Coast prepare for two tropical storms this week. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, we pray for our community and our nation. We ask that you give the leaders compassion and wisdom, remembering that their lives rest in your care. We ask for a hand of protection for those who protect us, those who are serving the firefighters and the first responders, no matter where they serve. And we ask a hand of protection for ourselves. We ask for an extra measure of faith so that as doubts rise, we may meet them with confidence and emerge as strong witnesses to your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Holy Spirit, we bring to you these and all of our prayers, knowing that you hear all of the joys and the troubles of our heart, even the ones we cannot put into words. We ask for all of these things in the powerful name of Jesus, as he taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, now let us prepare to enter the world with our hymn of celebration, My Hope is Built. am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. Go, Church of God, into a world that might live as one, and others will know us by our love. Go with the blessings of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Ceaseless.